Okay, hello and welcome to the Capitola Planning Commission meeting of July 15th. And we're glad you're here joining us. This meeting tonight is not physically open to the public. Commissioners and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for you to watch and participate. There'll be a slide on the screen showing you how you can participate. And if we could have that slide up, there it is. So there's several different ways, by calling in and raising your hand to wait to be unmuted. So hope you can join us. And as always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications, Cable TV Channel 8, and AT&T UVerse Channel 99. Our tech tonight is Armin Toyd. And thank you, Armin, for doing this. And with that, may we have the roll call, please, Edna.
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Here.
Commissioner Newman?
Present.
Commissioner Westman? Commissioner Westman?
He's muted. Commissioner Westman, you have to unmute yourself.
I'm here. Sorry.
Oh, thank you. Commissioner Wilk?
Here.
And Chair Ruth?
Here.
Thank you.
Okay, now we'll have the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America,
and to the republic
for which it stands,
one nation,
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I'll be glad when we can do that live.
Yeah.
Okay. Next item on our agenda tonight is oral communications. And Katie or Matt, do we have any additions or deletions to the agenda?
We do not have any additions or deletions to the agenda. However, we've had quite a few public comment come in for an item that's being continued. So I just wanted to start by just stating that the tree removal on the in the Cherry Avenue right-of-way will be continued to the September 2nd hearing this evening. It's on the consent agenda. At this point, there's no staff report that lists all the details of this application, so it would be inappropriate to discuss the application prior to it occurring on September 2nd. So just a announcement for the public that that is on consent. The recommendation is to continue to September 2nd so that PG&E has time to look at other alternatives, and then we'll be bringing it back on September 2nd at 7 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. Next is public comments. If there's anyone out there that would like to address the commission tonight about any items that are not currently on the agenda, now's the time. We'll give you a little bit of time to weigh in here if you have something to add.
I am not seeing any attendees raise their hand at this time.
Okay, with that then we'll move on. We can always come back if someone's a little tardy. Commission comments. Any thing to add from the commissioners?
No.
No.
Okay, we'll move on from there then. Staff comments.
I do have a comment that I'd like to start this meeting with. A very valued member of our team has decided, Matt Orbach, our associate planner, has decided to take a new position with another city. And I just want to reflect on what an excellent addition he has been to the Capitola team. He's been here for over 4 years at this point, started off as assistant planner, was promoted to associate planner 2 years in, and just has really been an asset to our team. Highly motivated individual who always gives 100%, and I've just enjoyed the last 4.5 years working with him, and I know he's given his all for the city and appreciate all the time he has been here and wish him all the best in his new endeavor. So thank you, Matt.
Thank you, Katie. We're going to miss you.
Thanks. It's been an honor and a privilege to work with you folks here and do a lot of great stuff here for the city of Capitola. And, you know, I wish everybody the best and the best for the city. I got a great opportunity with the city of Watsonville. It's, you know, a much larger city with a very different set of issues that are going to be pretty fun to work on. So just taking that opportunity. So
we're going to miss you. I'll miss you.
Yeah. Best of luck to you.
Thank you.
Good luck, Matt.
Yeah, good luck in that position.
You've been a great help.
Thanks.
I'm sure our loss is Watsonville's gain. Okay, moving on then. The next item is the approval of minutes. We have two sets of minutes tonight, one from the May 6th meeting and one from the June 3rd meeting. I can't recall if everyone was present at both those meetings. I don't have those in front of me right now, but probably best to take them separately. Those are any additions or corrections to the May 6th meeting?
No, I'll make a motion to approve those minutes.
I'll second. This is Commissioner Wilk.
Okay, we have a motion and a second then to approve the minutes from May 6th. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Commissioner Christensen?
Thurman?
Commissioner Christensen?
Is it?
Edna, may we have the roll call, please?
Yes, can you hear me, Chair Ruth?
Well, I'll call the roll. Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
And Commissioner Ruth votes aye. So the motion carries. Those minutes are approved. Now we have the regular meeting of June 3rd to approve. Any additions or corrections to those minutes? Hearing none, there's first or a motion to approve?
Move approval. This is Commissioner Newman.
Mr. Wilk will second.
We have a motion and a second. We'll call the roll again. Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
And Chairman Ruth votes aye. So those minutes are approved. So that brings us to our consent calendar tonight. And the first item A, the tree removal on Cherry Avenue right-of-way, has been continued to our September meeting. So we'll just...
Point of order? This is Commissioner Wilk. I would like to remove that from the consent calendar for discussion.
For tonight or for the September meeting?
For tonight.
But that's been continued.
It's been continued to September.
Can't we deny that continuance?
And hear it tonight?
And discuss it tonight, and at least acknowledge the inputs for tonight, and discuss PG&E's alternative motives, perhaps, or I think there's a lot of issues that at least should be brought on the table. There are 42 people who have commented on this, and they shouldn't be ignored.
Well, I don't think they're being ignored. It's just being continued, but let's get a consensus from the commission.
I think it's advertised as an agenda item that's going to be continued for tonight, and I know several people who are very interested in this item, and they're not watching our meeting tonight because they know the agenda listed it as an item that's being continued to September. So I think it would be a disservice to discuss it tonight when we've already told people it will be continued to September. And I appreciate all of the comments that I've received. I think we all take them to heart, but it would be inappropriate to discuss it tonight.
Yeah, Susan, I think those are valid comments, and I think we will just not discuss it since it has been continued and we can discuss it at that point. So the next item...
I think it's an interesting point of order as to whether or not now it's just an academic question from my standpoint whether or not we can pull anything from the consent calendar, because I thought we were able to do that. Anyone was able to pull an item from the consent calendar by rule.
Well, then let's get a consensus from the council from the commission.
Commissioner Newman, I agree with Susan, Commissioner Westman. And I also think that since we've had so much reaction from the public that it would be good to get input from PG&E in terms of how they want to address that before we get too deep into this.
Okay, Commissioner Christensen.
This is actually the conversation I wanted to have as part of pulling it from the consent calendar. But all right, I'll withdraw my concerns.
Okay, so we're going to move on to we're on the consent calendar. I would like to pull 4855 Topaz Street for discussion. And if we could have a staff report on that, please, either Matt or Katie.
That would need to be 1 second.
Okay.
Tonight we have 4855 Topaz Street. The applicant is proposing to demolish an existing 291 square foot attached garage and construct a new 282 square foot attached garage and a new 630 square foot attached accessory dwelling unit at 4855 Topaz Street. Next slide, please. This is the street view, so everyone can see the front yard because this is going to come into play a little bit later. Next slide, please. This is the street view also, but from a slightly different angle of the existing residence at 4855 Topaz Street. The existing residence here is a non-conforming two-story single-family residence. It's located in the Jewel Box neighborhood, surrounded by one- and two-story single-family homes. And I specifically put this in here just so you can see the roof pitch of the existing garage. Next slide, please.
Excuse me, Matt, before you leave those pictures, if you could back up to that last picture.
I just want to point
out that picture is probably about 4 or 5 years old, because that tree on the left now is much larger, and those plants in the planted right-of-way in the front are no longer there.
Okay. I believe it was from 2020, so I apologize for using a year out of date photo on that. This project is not proposing the removal of any of that, any of the trees or any of the landscaping. So sorry, Sean, can you go to the slide with the site plan, please? So here's the site plan showing the location of the ADU and the proposed garage. The new garage is located 10 feet closer to the front of the lot to accommodate the new attached ADU addition off the back of Adam. The proposed attached garage complies with the 20-foot front yard setback. I did show that picture even a full lot of date to show that the current front yard is almost fully paved other than the small landscaping strips along the front property line and landscaping strip adjacent to the front of the residence and around the base of the two trees in the front yard. The applicant is required to add one parking space for the ADU due to the existing site constraints, the parking space for the ADU will be in the front yard setback. Code requires that parking for an ADU in the front setback should be a ribbon or Hollywood design, which we discussed not too long ago with our ADU code update. And it's designed with two parallel strips of pavement. Unpaved areas between the strips shall be landscaped with turf or low-growing ground cover. So given that the yard is fully landscaped, to comply with the standard, the applicant is proposing to add a strip of turf or low-growing ground cover in between the two paved areas that will serve as the paver parking strip areas. Next slide, please. Here's the proposed floor plans. You can see kind of on the top, on the right-hand image on the top part is the accessory dwelling unit that's being added. On the lower left is the garage. Next slide, please. And here are the proposed elevations. Proposed elevations. The front design includes the new pitched roof of the garage that matches the existing residence with composition shingles. And the new attached garage and the attached ADU have horizontal siding to match the existing single-family residence. I should also point out that this is another one of those projects where the ADU is an administrative approval. So it's not really up for discussion tonight. Tonight, what is up for discussion is the relocation of the garage because the ADU will be approved administratively. So, next slide, please. With that, staff recommends the Planning Commission approves the project based on the conditions of approval and findings.
Okay, thank you, Matt. The reason I brought this up was a concern I have for the ADU parking space. I know the ordinance allows the parking in the front yard setback. But I was out there today, and I attempted to park where that parking space would be. That tree that looks like a little stick in the picture is now much larger, and I'm in a small car. There were no other cars in the driveway, and I had a very difficult time to get into that space. I don't think a larger car could do it. I know on Depot Hill, that house that was on, I believe it was on El Salto or Escalon, I can't recall which, but we allowed them for their parking to encroach in that unused right-of-way area. And if you look at that, I guess it would be the plan map that shows the plot plan on there. There is room. No, next one, I believe. The one that shows the parking space.
That one.
This one. Okay, there is room between that tree on the right and the front of the house to park a full-size car if we allow them to use that area between the curb and the property line. And it becomes a usable space at that time and will probably alleviate some parking problems this will create in the neighborhood. So, you know, while I see and know that we allow parking in the front yard setback, I think it has to be a usable parking space. And this is not a usable parking space as proposed. So those are my comments.
So can I ask a question of Chairperson Ruth?
Sure.
The tree that's there, because I went out and looked at this too, seems like it's not quite 6 inches in diameter yet. I think we measure trees 20 inches up, and if they're more than 6 inches in diameter, they need to have a permit to have it removed. I mean, I think this tree is pretty borderline on that. Would it be acceptable to you if that tree was moved and another tree was located on the property? You think you would be able to get into the parking place then?
Probably, yeah. If you're coming from the west, you can get into it easy. If you're coming from the east, it'd be extremely difficult. I'm not sure if the property owner wants to remove that tree because it's the same kind of tree as the other tree, and they kind of make a nice canopy over the front yard. But I think it's entirely possible to move the parking space just to the left of the second tree.
Are you talking about one that would be perpendicular to the street?
Right.
Yeah, the problem is that they would have to request a variance to not have the parking space entirely on the lot, and that's not how the application has been taken in, so I don't think we could...
Matt, we just did that for that house on Depot Hill.
I think you discussed the fact that was used for parking and would like to keep it clear from people parking, but that was not actually counted as one of their required parking spaces. So the alternative design that you're proposing would require a variance.
Okay. I'd be willing to support a variance, but I can't support it in its current configuration. So it'll be up to the commission.
I have a quick question. Commissioner Christensen has a question. Does that parking space, the one that Commissioner Ruth is questioning, is it meet the correct area for a parking space?
Yes.
Thank you.
It raises a very interesting question because the feasibility of these, Hollywood style strip spaces that are parallel to streets are going to run into this challenge in a lot of cases. This was kind of an exception that was allowed under the state law that may not have been fully thought through in terms of functionality. So you bring up some great points, but I do believe that if you were going to require them to do the other parking arrangement, it would require variance and have to come back at a different meeting so it could be advertised correctly, noticed correctly.
Okay.
So could I have some more clarification? This is Commissioner Wilk. So
Commissioner Ruth, you said you tried to use that space. So you try to you pulled in the driveway and tried to make a hard right turn into that space.
Right.
And it was That's too right. difficult without a 3-point turn, or just couldn't.
Well, in order to land on that space, I would say before I completed my turn, my car was probably maybe 4 or 5 inches from the trunk of the tree. And I still had a ways to go. So it's very tight. That's why I don't think it will be usable. And I was in a small car. If you have a medium-sized car or a full-size car, an SUV, that space is totally unusable.
So you mean between, so I'm just trying to envision this. So you got the trunk of the tree on one side, and then the planter or the house, I guess, itself, or the
well, that tree sits right on the apex of the turn you have to make.
Right. Oh, so you're saying that you would scrape the passenger side door with any car any larger than yours?
You got it.
No, this is Commissioner Westman. I have a procedural question. Matt indicated that the ADU unit is not up for discussion tonight. That's strictly a ministerial permit. And so this parking space that's being provided for the ADU, isn't that part of the ministerial permit, not what we get to comment on?
That is actually correct. The ADU parking space is associated with the administratively approved ADU.
That, and Commissioner Westman, yes, that is correct. And there's
okay. Go ahead, Katie.
So that is how we should review this. That is part of the ADU that should be removed. It should be reviewed administratively. Just for clarification, there are a couple items like with it that just for additional information, but I don't think it can be reviewed this evening. If we were to look at adding an additional space through it, a different means for the ADU, we have a limit for how many for driveway cuts in the width of a driveway in the R1 district, because we try to allow street parking and encourage street parking, and that's why you don't see many Capitola homes with more than one parking space. And within our new code, I'm just going to read a section of this to you. But so within the R1 district, the width of a mac of the parking space in the required front yard, it may not exceed 40% of the lot width, up to a maximum of 20 feet, except that all lots may have a parking space up to 14 feet in width, regardless of lot width. And then there's a new allowance for the Planning Commission to allow larger parking areas within the front and exterior side yards with a design permit if the larger parking area incorporates design features such as impervious materials and enhanced landscaping, which minimize visual impacts. But typically when we have an application that comes in with two driveway cuts, we'll have a review by also the Public Works Director to see what the impact is to on-street parking. Because once you make an additional cut, you do lose one, and in some instances, two spaces along the street. So, but I do think the review of the parking space, because it's tied to the ADU, should not be included in this review, because if we just had the application for an ADU, it would be approved administratively.
So since this is purely an administrative approval, is the only thing we're allowed to discuss tonight the proposed garage?
That's correct.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
However,
okay, well, I'll withdraw my concern then.
I do think if there was a suggestion on the tree, we could relay that to the applicant. And if you were suggesting removing the tree to make...
I'm not suggesting removing the tree. Okay, well, with that, if there's no further discussion, we'll call for the question. Is there a motion to approve?
Well, do we want to do the whole consent calendar now?
Well,
we didn't vote on the other item either.
Well, we didn't have anything to vote on. We just continued it.
we do need a vote to continue it, and because this item was pulled off the consent agenda, I would suggest that we should, okay, so procedurally, since this was pulled off the consent agenda, we've heard the commissioner comments, we should open the public hearing, and then I would suggest after we have a motion and a vote, we should return to the consent agenda to also make a motion on the PG&E tree.
Wait, you've lost me, Katie.
Because there's been.
What are we opening a public hearing on?
4855 Topaz, since the commission discussed it. We should open the public hearing.
Okay, well, I'm a little confused as to what the action should be other than an approval.
So you took it off the consent calendar, so now it's just a regular agenda item, so you have to go through the regular rigmarole.
Okay, but it's not a public hearing. I just pulled it off for discussion. That doesn't make it a public hearing.
I don't agree with that. This is Commissioner Newman. I think if Commissioner Ruth retracts his pulling it from the consent agenda, it just goes back to the consent agenda.
Which I have done.
You are corrected.
Okay, is there a motion to approve the consent calendar or the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the two items on the consent agenda.
I'll second, Mr. Horstman.
Edna, are you here to do the roll call?
Yes, Chair Ruth, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
I'll abstain because I'm really disqualified on the Topaz.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, motion carries. Consent calendar is approved with the tree on Cherry Avenue continued to the September meeting. So that brings us to public hearings. Item A is 4875 Opal Street, design permit for the construction of a new single-family residence on a vacant lot on the corner of Opal and 49th. The house we're considering is not directly on the corner, but it's just inside from the corner. Matt?
Thank you, Chair Ruth, and good evening, commissioners. This is Sean here. The applicant is proposing to construct a new two-story single-family residence. This property is a vacant lot within the single-family zoning district. This is just a front view of the property. It's surrounded otherwise by one- and two-story single-family homes in the Jewel Locks neighborhood. As mentioned, it's adjacent to the corner property of 503 49th Avenue, which is a separate legal lot but is owned by the same party. The planning department is also reviewing a separate development application for that corner property, which is expected to go before the planning commission this September. The proposed site plan. Parking is provided by a single car garage and a two car driveway. The proposed home is only actually required to have two parking spaces, one of which must be covered. However, the applicant preferred having a third space. In the rear, there are also included two trees for planting. This would secure the 15% canopy coverage for new residential development applications. These are the proposed floor plans. Here are the proposed elevations. The new residence amounts to 1,834 square feet for a maximum floor area ratio of 55.9%. The proposed residence has incorporated privacy considerations with high second story windows and a recessed balcony door on the west elevation. The proposed second story deck, as previously mentioned, is in the front, which faces Opal Street and the adjacent corner property at 503 49th Avenue. here is the proposed landscape plan. Landscape plan was not revised to reflect the latest driveway design and the proposed tree varieties. Condition of approval number 6, which is included in all new residential development applications, requires the applicant to submit a landscape plan that matches the site plan prior to the issuance of a building permit. And with that, staff recommends the Planning Commission approve the project based on the conditions of approval and findings.
Thank you, Sean. Interesting to note that this is the last vacant parcel. It's been divided into two lots now that exists in the Jewel Box area. So with that, we'll open the public hearing. If the applicant is present, we could hear from the applicant or his representative, Mr. Norton. Are either of you present?
I don't actually see Mr. Norton present, and I don't believe the property owners are either.
Okay. If there's any members of the public wishing to comment on this item of 4875 Opal Street, a new single family home, now's the time. We'll give you some time here to call in or join the meeting.
And I'm not seeing any public comment on this item either in our email system.
I'm sorry, Katie, what was that you said? Oh. Couldn't hear you.
Within the public comment email, there are no public comments submitted
okay.
on this item.
Okay, then we'll move on and bring it back to the commission. Who would like to lead off? Or if anybody would like to lead off. Hearing no comments, is there a motion to approve this application?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I move to approve this application as with staff's comments.
And I'll second it. This is Commissioner Westman.
Okay, then we have a motion and a second to approve the application to construct a new single family home at 4875 Opal Street. May the roll call, please, Edna.
Commissioner Christensen? Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Yes.
Commissioner Westman?
Yes.
Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
And Chair Ruth?
Yes.
Thank you.
So the motion carries, and there will be a new home at that site. So that brings us to item B, and this is the SB2 pre-approved ADU program overview. And we have a staff presentation on this tonight. Going to be Katie.
This will be Matt this evening. His last
Matt.
Presentation to the Planning Commission.
Back to me. All right. So tonight we have the SB2 pre-approved ADU program overview, something we've been mentioning for a while but haven't been able to bring to you. So now we've completed our public survey and everything and have our contractor contracted, and so I'll jump right into it. I'm going to give a little bit of background here, and then we'll get into survey results, and then at the end there will be an opportunity for the planning commissioners to give us some feedback on the design and size elements of this as well. So using SB2 funds received from the California Department of Housing and Community Development, the City of Capitola has contracted with Workbench and Meta Urban Designs to create an ADU program. That's accessory dwelling units. I'll define that at the beginning here because we'll be using that term a lot. Program that includes guidance documents and 4 prototype designs. The purpose of this overview is to review the SB2 pre-approved ADU program, including the project timeline, deliverables, and opportunities for input from the Planning Commission and the public. So SB2 grant funds were made available to jurisdictions to accelerate housing production. For the City of Capitola, this will be achieved by assisting property owners with ADU development. There are 2 main deliverables for Capitola's ADU program. The first is to create guidance documents to inform the public and design professionals of Capitola's ADU standards and the permitting process. Second deliverable is producing architectural and building plans for 4 ADU prototypes that would fit on a typical lot in Capitola and will be available at no cost to Capitola residents. So a little background on how we got here. On February 8th, 2021, the city published a request for proposals to develop this ADU program. The RFP was published for 28 days, and the city received four proposals from qualified applicants. We put together a committee, a selection committee, composed of our local architect, Frank Fanton, Planning Commissioner Christensen, myself, and building official Robin Woodman. We reviewed the submittals and identified Workbench as the top applicant. A little background on Workbench here. Workbench is a woman-owned architecture and construction company based in Santa Cruz with expertise in ADU design and development. The Workbench proposal included a subcontract with Samantha Suter, who is the owner of Meta Urban Design, to assist with creating the ADU public outreach tools. Both have experience with ADUs, having recently created prototype ADU designs for the city's Seaside, and currently working on an ADU toolkit for the city of Milpitas, who I contacted as part of our review and got great reviews. Brian Rubin is in attendance tonight. If the Planning Commission has specific questions for Workbench during or after the presentation, and if we're still going, I believe Samantha will be joining us a little bit later as well. So in terms of deliverables related to the guidance documents, we will be getting a detailed step-by-step ADU handbook, a quick reference ADU brochure, an ADU application, ADU checklist for plan submittal, a frequently asked question document, public-facing imagery such as graphics, and an update to the text of the ADU page on the City of Capitola website with links to all of the previously listed items. What these items will do is define the types of ADUs, provide illustrations showing what these building forms can look like on a typical Capitola lot, explain the new state regulations for ADUs using illustrations and graphics to distill really technical ordinances and state laws into more easily understood information, create content that describes the benefits of ADUs, and direct users to external resources to excite and inspire them about adding an ADU to their property. They'll also present and explain the prototypical ADU plans that are going to be developed as part of this and the other deliverable to help property owners identify the best option for their individual properties. And it will also guide property owners through the design and permitting process. The other half of this is the prototype designs. And in terms of those deliverables, there will be four detached ADU floor plans for homeowners that will include several architectural styles as well as options for different interior and exterior finishes. The plans will be designed to fit into a typical property in Capitola, which I know I've said that a few times now, but I will define that a little later after the end of the survey review. And we'll cover a range of sizes from the minimum size of 220 square feet up to the maximum limited standards ADU size of 800 square feet. And these prototypes will be developed to the point where they're building code compliant and only require approval of an administrative ADU permit and a building permit, which will be able to be applied for concurrently. The project is currently in the information gathering and conceptual design phase. After tonight, the Planning Commission will also have opportunities to review and provide input on the schematic and final design. During the next step of the schematic design review, the Commission will review the draft floor plans and exterior elevations for the four prototypes and provide feedback on any design changes they would like to see incorporated into those plans. Workbench will then make the recommended changes to the plans. The design process will continue through the fall with Planning Commission and City Council review of the final designs tentatively scheduled for November. Following approval of the architectural plans, the building plans for the approved designs will be created with the final project deliverables tentatively scheduled for approval in March 2022. As mentioned earlier, there was a public survey that was shared between June 22nd and July 14th. This was hosted by the Workbench people as part of their website, but there was a link to it from the city website, and there were notifications that it sent out on social media from the city's account, such as Facebook and Instagram. The survey was designed to solicit input on the level of interest in building ADUs, size and architectural style preferences, and other relevant design questions. The survey received 56 responses, and I have a few the following slides here that highlight some of the important feedback that was received via that survey. So question one was, what best describes you? And 40 out of 56 survey respondents indicated that they own property in Capitola and reside in Capitola. The results
results of question three indicate that the largest number of respondents live in or near the Riverview Terrace, Cliffwood Heights, Jewel Box, and 41st Avenue West Capitola neighborhoods, as shown on the map from our general plan here. Results of question five show that the largest number of respondents would use the ADU for living space for friends or and or family. Only 17 respondents actually indicated that they would use the ADU as a long-term rental unit. Significant numbers of respondents also indicated that they would use the ADU as living space for visiting guests or as a home office, music, art studio, hobby space, or something similar. In addition, 42 of the 56 survey respondents would like to build a detached ADU on their property, which is good news for us in terms of receiving feedback from respondents regarding size and design that's very specifically relevant to this project, because all four of the pre-approved ADU designs will be detached ADUs. Questions 7 and 8 were closely related, soliciting feedback on how much of their backyards respondents were willing to cover with an ADU and what size ADU they would prefer. Most respondents were interested in preserving half or as much as possible of their backyard, and 48% of respondents preferred the smallest size ADU to accommodate their needs. In the same vein, the results of question 9 indicate that the overwhelming majority of respondents are interested in studio or one-bedroom units, 28 respondents and 22 respondents respectively. And in question number 10, 68% of respondents indicated that they preferred a mini kitchen as opposed to a full kitchen. Questions 7 through 10 show interest in smaller ADUs with less kitchen amenities as opposed to larger ADUs with more kitchen amenities. Question 11 solicited feedback on architectural style. This is where it gets a little bit more fun. Staff consulted local historian Carolyn Swift to identify typical, quote-unquote, typical architectural styles here in the city of Capitola. The styles that we identified included craftsman, farmhouse, beach cottage vernacular, and Spanish colonial. The modern style choice was added in a little bit later based on the fact that it's just a currently popular design for ADUs in other regions of the state and country. Respondents were asked to identify their top three choices. The overall top choice was beach cottage vernacular, shown here as D. I know that the words are a little hard to read there. Followed by craftsman and farmhouse, which are B and C. They each received 26 votes. It's 42 votes for the beach cottage vernacular. Modern received 17 votes, and Spanish colonial only received 5 votes. Question 12 got a little bit more specific and solicited feedback on siding material types. Respondents were asked to identify their top three choices as well here. The overall top choice was horizontal siding, followed by board and batten and shingles. Vertical siding also received 15 votes. Stucco received 9 votes, and stone only received 2. And the last one here, I asked about roofing materials. This one also included an option of prefer a range of options to choose from. Once again, they were asked about their top three choices. The top answer was composition shingle with 34 votes, followed by standing seam metal with 29 votes, and then prefer a range of options to choose from with the third highest vote getting with 24 votes. Spanish tile only received 4. Question 14 and 15 dealt with the cost and time expectations related to the ADU permitting and construction process. 45% of respondents estimated that their budget for permitting and construction of an ADU will be less than $100,000, and 54% of respondents expect the total permitting and construction process to take less than 6 months. These expectations indicate that guidance documents and outreach materials should definitely focus on educating property owners about the cost and time required for permitting and construction of ADUs, so that they can have a realistic expectation heading into this. So that's the overview of what we have gotten so far from the public. At this point, I'd like to give a little feedback from the Planning Commission on some of the same items that were covered in that survey. So I've divided this into two parts. The first covers ADU sizes, and the second part deals with architectural styles. I can either stop at the end of the ADU sizes section, then we can discuss it there and then move on, or I can cover both, and then we can just circle back and get the commissioner's opinions on both at the same time. Do you have one that you would prefer?
I have a question on procedure.
or process. So this whole activity, you come up with these four prototypes, and is the idea of those prototypes with the existing plans to specify that those are the only approved detached units, or those are the ones that you can have for free and thereby save the cost of creating your own plans?
It's the latter of those two. It's definitely designed to help streamline and expedite and reduce costs for property owners who are interested in that. These are definitely not the only types of detached ADUs you will be able to have. As I mentioned earlier, with the, you know, a maximum size of 800 square feet as well, you know, you're welcome to go bigger than that, up to 1,200 square feet. This is designed for the specific, you know, subset of people who are really trying to keep, you know, time and cost down on their project.
Got it. That makes a lot of sense now. Then secondly, the question of we're going over styles and materials. Again, is this the idea of saying that these are the Capitola approved materials and none others will be approved?
No, this will be related simply to those four designs that will be designed for people trying to keep cost and time down. You know, as with most projects, we really don't regulate siding materials. So, you know, if someone wanted to go with something different, they can. This is just soliciting your individual feedback as a planning commissioner on those styles, so that it gives a little bit of direction to Workbench in terms of what to put on the outside of these when they bring back their schematic designs for you at the next meeting.
So once again, let me clarify just to make sure that I know exactly what's going on here. So an applicant, as they can now, can apply for an ADU and like we have today, submit a design to their liking, go through the trouble and expense of creating those plans and getting staff approval. That still will always be the case. What you're doing is adding a cost savings and an incentive program that says, hey, applicants, if you use this template, bam, it's free and you can do it and it'll be cheaper for you and it'll be administratively easy for all concerned. Is that correct?
Yeah, it gives them, there will be a set number of options for each of these pre-approved ADU prototypes. And so what we're not going to have all of the things listed, obviously. They're going to have to pare it down to a set number. So what we want to get is an idea of what members of the public and planning commissioners would like to see as those limited set of options for these four pre-approved ADU prototypes.
So if they decided to come with one of the four that is compliant with everything, except they decided to go with different materials and roofing that's not pre-approved, all that means is they have to submit the plan separately and have them administratively go through the rigmarole. Is that?
Yeah, I mean, it would go through the same approval process. It's just they would be, yeah, you know, you're allowed a lot of flexibility and creativity with those aspects of these projects. So this is much more about the floor plans and just giving people sort of some ideas to build off of. And yeah, you know, they're not going to have set prices. This is something I've actually discussed with Workbench, because, you know, the prices of those materials do fluctuate too. So we're not going to have fixed numbers on these. So, you know, it's going to be designed with a certain number of options. And then if someone wants to go and say stucco, which, you know, in this survey didn't get a lot of votes, they're welcome to do that. And they can do that as part of that same approval process. So
just, again, bear with me. So if in fact the planning commission and the, let's say the community at large decided that they didn't like stucco and the stucco does not belong in Capitola, this nevertheless doesn't prohibit anyone from building a stucco ADU. It's
That's
just
correct.
Going to be more expensive or more trouble, slightly more troublesome.
Yeah, it's like a restaurant menu where there's a set menu, but you're welcome to, you know, as long as the chef is amenable, which our city of Capitola chef is, you can make changes to the menu items.
Thank you. That was very helpful, Matt.
Thank you, Commissioner Wilk. Any questions for Matt?
I just have one quick one. One of the things that concerns me, and it showed up in the survey, is the majority of these ADU units are being built, and we're fast-tracking them and making exceptions because we want to provide more housing, but they're not being used for housing. Is there any ability that this city has to say that, you know, if you get to build one of these ADUs, it's supposed to be for housing?
No, and unfortunately, that's a byproduct of how the state law was written. They, you know, wanted to just expedite the construction of these. But, you know, as we've noticed from our self-certification letter that we sent out, a lot of these are being used just for family and friends and extra living space, and there's no real way to regulate that under the framework that we have, at least at this point, given to us by the state law.
But the requirement for a commission kind of drives that, doesn't it?
Commissioner Westman?
Can you hear me? This is
Kim. No, that's fine. I didn't think there was anything we could do to require them to be actual living, adding to the housing stock or being living units. But it seems sort of a shame because we're getting a lot more lot coverage and a lot bigger structures on the individual lots without accomplishing the goal that, you know, evidently these ADUs were supposed to accomplish.
I have a comment to follow Commissioner Westman. I've been talking to a couple of different jurisdictions, the, you know, City of Santa Cruz and County of Santa Cruz, and a couple of people brought up some really good points in response to that, because that was something I thought of as well. And they said that, you know, the long game is more of what they're looking at, and if they have a legal dwelling on their property, it doesn't mean that this current owner is going to utilize it as a living space to rent it out to a family or a person besides friends and family. But, you know, maybe the next owner or in the lifetime of that property, it's still a legal dwelling. So I thought that was kind of a good point that the city or the state is affording, you know, so much more lot coverage and offered living space so that at one point in the lifetime of that property, it'll be used. That makes sense? Because I brought up the same point a little while ago, and I thought that was a good response I thought I'd offer.
Thank you, Courtney.
One other question. Excuse me, Commissioner Ruth. This is Commissioner Wilk. Just curious, are these ADUs, do they have a separate address?
No, it would be an A and B type situation.
So the postman would have a separate mailbox, but it would be, okay.
Yeah.
Same address, but A and B.
Okay, I have a question. Are we locked into having four options?
That is what the funding amount allowed for in terms of, you know, what we've worked out with Workbench and the dollar amount of the contract and what can be produced in this amount of time. For that amount of money. So we originally said 4 to 5, but then we leaned in to doing 4 with multiple interior and exterior design options rather than 5 without design options. So.
Okay. Yeah. This is any other comments, questions before we open it to the public?
Oh, no, I still have more presentation too, by the way. So question I posed was whether you wanted to stop at each one of these and discuss the size and the architectural styles, or whether I should just go through both of those and then we can discuss them afterwards.
I'd like to address that question, if I may.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's great that we got a grant and some money's coming to the city, but I really am skeptical of the utility of this exercise. I don't think we should spend any time on commissioner opinions of ADU size. The law is the law on that, and the people will build what they want to build. And you can get all kinds of canned ADU plans online very inexpensively. So, you know, the extent to which this is facilitating the construction of housing for needed housing in California is, in my opinion, extremely minimal. And I just don't think we should waste a lot of time on our opinion of whether a 200-foot or a 250-foot ADU is we like.
Okay, noted. we do have our need to go through this exercise so that we can give some guidance to Workbench on specific sizes. So I think this will become a little more clear after I go through that number one. So why don't I just go ahead and go into it? And I'll stop at the end of the size section, and we can discuss whether you'd like to discuss that more there, or move on to architectural styles and then do it all at once. So, all right. So that I did say earlier that I was going to go into what a typical lot in Capitola is by neighborhood. So what I did with this is I analyzed typical lots in Capitola by neighborhood, and the results are shown in this table. Don't worry, I'm not going to go through it line by line. Based on the most common lot dimensions and the corresponding setback requirements and building envelopes, there are certain sizes of detached ADUs that could work in certain neighborhoods. However, the building envelopes of some neighborhoods would not allow for an ADU at all. This will obviously vary based on existing conditions of each individual lot, because some lots in the not feasible neighborhoods shown in this chart may have primary residences with larger rear setbacks or larger side setbacks that would actually allow for the construction of a detached ADU. But I needed to do something to get us some typical lot sizes. With that, I put together a list of potential ADU sizes based on what would work in certain neighborhoods and other constraints as shown above. For example, it's important to note that once an ADU reaches 640 square feet, Soco Creek Water District, if someone's in the Soco Creek rather than City of Santa Cruz, actually jumps by $10,000 based on the projected water use for larger ADUs. Given the survey results showing a preference for smaller ADUs, it may be preferable to keep multiple units of the four that we're designing below that 640 square foot mark to reduce costs for property owners. What I'm requesting here is input from you on what you'd like to see in terms of unit sizes, either with specific square footage targets, 220, 400, 600, 800, or just general guidance, if we can get to a consensus, such as, three of the four units should be under 640 square feet.
Do we have any say-so if someone wants to build an 800-square-foot ADU and it conforms to all the standards?
No, once again, we're only dealing with the four pre-approved prototypes that were going to be designed as part of this grant. People are still welcome to build whatever they want, within the code outside of that on their own, custom projects. So
we're talking
only for the four pre-approved
size prototypes. Of the prototypes, then?
Yes.
Okay.
If I voted, I would vote to build the first, have the design be 1, 2, 3, and 4. Small one, a little bit bigger, and up to 640 square feet.
Hey, I vote for all five of them and none of them.
How many parking spaces are required for 640 square feet if it's two bedrooms?
The way our code reads, it's just one per unit. So, and it just varies geographically. There's certain areas that don't have to provide parking at all. But if they do, the maximum we require is one parking space. So size and bedrooms don't actually matter under the way we have written our code.
So this is Commissioner Wilk. So again, with an understanding is this is just guidance. And so what this does is kind of push people in certain directions who want to get it done quickly. If I wanted to push someone in a particular direction, I'd want to push them in the direction that minimizes our water use. So that would be this, because it's a good thing you pointed that out about the extra fees. So I would just prefer 1, 2, and 3 simply because, I would want just one or two people in these dwellings and just to save our water.
And then maybe a fourth one that falls just within that 220 to 520 range. Because we have four to design. So you said 1, 2, 3, and then we would just say just another one in that range of 220 to 520.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I would concur with that because I think also if we get into these larger two-bedroom units, which are probably bigger than some of the houses in Capitola, then we're just encouraging more parking issues in the neighborhood. So I'd like to see just 1, 2, and 3 being our focus.
Yeah. I have a perspective, Commissioner Christensen. Mm-hmm. I feel like most people that I've talked to that want to actually build an ADU that they're going to rent in their yard they want, at least from my experience, they want the biggest amount that they can get on their parcel because they're going to spend the money to build something back there. They're like, well, how big can I get? And that's kind of the number one question I've heard. And I see this exercise as more of a kind of a blanket to help direct people's design and
execution of building the ADU. So we're almost getting out in front of this flood of ADU building, making them build it right, making them look right kind of thing. So I don't feel that excluding the larger ADUs is really doing us any favors. I think that that's just eliminating a group of people that will see the 640 square feet and be like, well, I can build an 800 square foot home, so, or ADU, so why, you know, that's, I just don't see the benefit of eliminating the 800 square foot option.
I think the point is that if we just do 1, 2, and 3, we're not encouraging those larger units. I think if we put 640, 800 square foot options, we're kind of encouraging those. And it gets back to Mr. Wilk, we're encouraging more water use, we're encouraging more parking problems. So if we stick with the smaller units, people can still build the bigger ones, but we're not encouraging those.
I see what you're saying, but we're not getting out in front of those larger ones in that regard. Does that make sense? That's my perspective. Is that we're kind of just saying, well, we're not encouraging it, but we're not really providing any guidance for those in terms of floor plans and elevations.
I don't mean to interrupt you, Courtney, but it was my understanding that this program was being done to help with the financial cost of building ADU.
Right.
That we're going to provide people with free plans. And once they go above 640 square feet, then they have to pay the extra $10,000 to SoCal. My feeling was, since we can only do four of them, if we did the four that were below the Soquel Creek Water District fee standard, those are going to be the people who are going to be most budget conscious and not want to pay the extra $10,000.
Yeah, so, I mean, I see that perspective as well.
Okay, thank you, Courtney. Any other comments? Okay, Matt, do we have any more to...
For Commissioner Christensen, what would be your four if you had to? You just would like to see them all the way across the spectrum from 220 to 800, including the large?
I just think addressing the large is a good idea.
Okay. And Commissioner Newman, did you have anything else to add other than what you already said?
I made my point.
Okay. Okay.
It sounds like we have a consensus on that, only to go up to possibly 520 or 640. I think we'll need to reach a consensus whether to go 1, 2, 3 or 1, 2, 3, 4 there.
I think I have enough to get Workbench to get started on those designs. So we'll work on that in-house with Workbench. All right, so the next is architectural style preferences. And I know there's probably going to be some opinions there. But I would like input from you on your top three architectural styles. It can be the ones shown here. You're welcome to recommend architectural styles that, you know, are not included in this list. But I would like to just get your feelings on architectural style.
Hey, well, my feelings are I'd like to see pitched roofs. And I would like to eliminate the style that has the flat roof. I mean, if we look at the neighborhoods where most of these are going to be built, those neighborhoods have pitched roofs, and I think the pitched roof is more compatible with the existing designs that we have in our community right now. So that's my preference. So let's hear from everybody else.
I don't really have a preference. I think that sometimes for neighbors, having a flat roof keeps the impact of a building being so close to the rear yard setback. You know, it lessens that impact. So for me, a variety of roof designs is fine.
I think we should let people build what they want to build, and I think they will build what they want to build. And I think coming up with a few prototypes to save them a few hundred dollars is pretty irrelevant.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Newman. Commissioner Wilk, Commissioner Christensen.
This is Commissioner Wilk. Oh, go ahead. Go ahead, Courtney.
Oh, no, I like all of them, too. I just, maybe with the exception of E, A and B seems the most applicable for most people's style around here.
Yeah, I prefer F.
Well, we have some pretty clear guidance from the public survey on this anyway, so maybe we'll just lean in towards their preferences. Okay. Well, I do have a couple more, just the same ones. So it didn't sound like you had much preference for overall style. How about for specifics? Any siding preferences? Or I know generally the Planning Commission as of late has been very open to whatever siding preferences people have, but anyone have a strong feeling?
No.
No preference here.
Okay. And then same with roofing? No preference?
I think they should have a roof.
we'll make sure that happens. Okay, so I think that's good. You're given Workbench a lot of freedom here, so I'm kind of excited to see what they're going to put together for this.
Okay, well, this is a public hearing, so we do have to open it up to anyone that has any comments from the public.
Okay, let me do my last line just real quick. Okay. About next steps, and then I'm done. So, so where do we go from here? Next, we're going to take the feedback that was received from both the public survey and Planning Commission tonight on preferred unit sizes and architectural styles, and we're going to convey that to Workbench and then begin working with them on creating the schematic design. And then also Meta Urban Design is going to start working on the outreach materials as well. And then, as I mentioned earlier in the timeline slide, the schematic designs will come back to Planning Commission. Right now, I have it tentatively scheduled for September, but sometime around that point when Workbench completes those schematic designs. So with that, I can hand it back to you, and we can have some public comment.
Okay. Thank you, Matt. So this is a public hearing to discuss any pre-approved ADU plans and program for the City of Capitola. If there's any member of the public out there wishing to give us your 2 cents on this program, now's the time. So there's how you join the meeting, and we'll give you a few seconds or a little bit of time here to make your comments.
Chair Ruth, I do not see any written public comments at this time, and we have no public attendees on the Zoom hearing at this time.
Okay, so with that, we'll close the public portion, and there's no action required on this. So we've given our direction to staff, so we'll bring it back to our agenda, and we're on the director's report. Katie?
Okay, thank you, Chair Ruth and Planning Commission. I just have a few updates for you. At our next Planning Commission meeting, we will be doing the 6-month review of our food vendor permit for the mobile vendors at the mall. So I wanted to encourage you all to, when you're in the area, please stop by, observe what's happening there, and write down any concerns you may have or recommendations, because we will be bringing back the 6-month review. At this point, I think it has continued with 2 vendors, and but that'll be returning to you in August. I also wanted to provide an update on the Rispin Park. Right now, currently, the city is $280,000 short of funding for the Rispin Park. So we do have a grant request in at the state, and we're hoping to know by the end of the summer whether or not we'll get those grant funds. And so we'll hopefully have funding, and if not, we'll be looking at other avenues for funding. And lastly, the wharf. The wharf, unfortunately, we did not get the grant money that was recently applied for. So that was $1.4 million we were hoping to get towards that design and construction. The Planning Commission, there's still a condition on the original permit that the bathrooms need to come back to Planning Commission for final review. We haven't forgotten that at this point. Because of the lack of funding, we're not putting money into the creating the design of the bathrooms until we definitely have funding to move forward with the project. So hopefully we'll be moving forward with Rispin sooner rather than later, and I'll keep you posted on the wharf. And lastly, the City Council at their last meeting reviewed outdoor dining for a permanent outdoor dining program in the village. As you know, under our new code, we have an allowance for outdoor dining outside of the coastal, well, actually just outside of the village in our community commercial and our neighborhood commercial areas. Businesses are now allowed to come in and apply for an administrative permit for outdoor dining. but within the village, it was prohibited under the new code. So we'll be working on a program, which you'll be seeing soon, modifying the language to allow a outdoor dining program within the village. At this point, the City Council recommended that we decrease, right now there's over 50 parking spaces utilized for outdoor dining. They suggested that the ordinance limit the program to 25 spaces. There's also a direction to waive, to not collect any fees for the actual permit review, but that there would be an annual fee to cover the cost of what's typically comes in for parking. And also direction for staff to begin working on, I think, one of your favorite new topics, prototype designs. So the city council has allocated $10,000 for us to go out and work on a prototype design. So this would be a more permanent project in which the city would be developing a design that could be approved administratively. So I will be coming back to you for feedback on that design in the near future, as well as an updated ordinance. So with that summarizes my updates, but at the council meeting next week, they'll be getting more information on the outdoor dining program for the future. And that finishes my director's report. And again, a big thank you to Matt Orbach for his time here at Capitola.
Thank you, Katie. This is Tommy.
I have a question for Katie about the wristband fund.
Yes.
So originally there was there was $320,000 that was allocated for that many years ago now. Was that all spent on the ADU compliance? Do you know where that money went?
I believe the money that was allocated for that is still there, but I don't believe we had it fully funded at any point. So I know for sure that we need $280,000 more in order to fund the park.
Okay, thank
you. But it definitely was not moved from wristband to ADUs. I can confirm that.
No, not EDU. ADU, compliance, ramp.
Oh, ADA.
ADA. You're thinking ADA. I'm sorry, ADA.
It may have gone towards that, because that was a project we were required to do in Rispin ahead of the actual park itself.
Okay, yeah, that's probably where it went. All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Commissioner Wilk. Any other communications from commissioners? Hearing none, then we will adjourn to our next meeting in August. And for those of you still watching and are interested in the palm tree, that has been continued until the September meeting. Okay. Meeting is adjourned.
Bye, Matt.
Bye, Matt.
Hi, thank you, everyone.
Bye, Matt. Goodbye.